the last day and greatest day of the feast, Jesus stood up and exclaimed, "Let anyone who thirsts come to me and drink. As Scripture says, rivers of living water will flow from within him who believes in me." He said this in reference to the Spirit that those who came to believe in him were to receive. There was, of course, no Spirit yet, because Jesus had not yet been glorified. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus.
As Scripture says, rivers of living water will flow from within him who believes in me. He said this in reference to the Spirit, that those who came to believe in him were to receive. There was, of course, no Spirit yet, because Jesus had not yet been glorified. On this Vigil of Pentecost, the Church gives us such a richness of sacred scripture to feast upon. Here, the words of Jesus and the Gospel could be misunderstood. This saying, there was, of course, no Spirit yet, because Jesus had not yet been glorified, could be understood wrongly in two ways at least. First, that the Spirit didn't exist. There was no Spirit yet. But that would be to deny the eternity of the third person of the Holy Trinity. The third person of the Trinity is God. He exists outside of time. He is God, one with the Father and the Son. So, of course, there was the Spirit. Before anything existed, God is. Second way that it can be misunderstood is that as if the Spirit had been inactive, might say dormant, until the glorification of Jesus. There was no Spirit, of course, yet, because Jesus had not yet been glorified. This would be to deny the creative work of the Spirit, which we hear in the very beginnings of the book of Genesis, hovering over the chaos of the waters and drawing things into the beauty that was to be material and immaterial creation. The creation of spirits, angels, and those that befall the demons, and the creation of man upon the earth. This is the work of the Creator Spirit, God. And we see the work of the Holy Spirit throughout the Old Testament. So, what Jesus and the Gospel of John is not saying is that the Spirit was not at work at all. So what is this referring to? Well, precisely what Jesus indicated here, he's referring back to that promise made in that we read from Joel, that the gift of the Spirit that would be given. And so we heard in the prophet Joel, "I will pour out my Spirit upon all flesh. Your sons and daughters shall prophesy. Your old men shall dream dreams. Your young men shall see visions, even upon servants and the handmaids. In those days I will pour out my Spirit." And so Jesus makes reference to that here. As Scripture says, rivers of living water will flow from within him who believes in me. There's other references in the Old Testament, prophesying of the gift of the Spirit that would dwell within man, and from within would be like a fountain of living water. And so we recognize, of course, here the imprint, the foreshadowing of the gift of baptism, that in the baptismal waters, man is made alive again in the Spirit. The Spirit comes to dwell within his creatures, which is makes man radically changed. The difference between the baptized and the unbaptized cannot be overestimated. Not as a way of rejecting the unbaptized or thinking of them as lacking human dignity by no means, but to recognize the dignity that has been given man by baptism, that God has so ennobled the human person that he has chosen to dwell within him, the very God himself, rivers of living water. This is a reference to the Holy Spirit. Rivers of living water will flow from within him who believes in me. Belief in the Lord Jesus is to gain access to a share in the life of God himself. The readings give us in short order sort of a picture of what is taking place in the history of man. Man, of course, has been expelled from the garden. Sin is a source of division. And so man who was in communion with God by sin is separated from God and separated from original creation. He leaves the garden. And so there's that beginning of division, and the division also to even the relationship between male and female that would so profoundly affect the rest of human history. And so man, we have the account of Genesis here this evening, man decides to make a name for himself. He's going to create an earthly city. He's going to try to reestablish paradise on his own terms. And God is loath to allow this. He does not want us to live in some lie that we can provide happiness for ourselves, a name for ourselves. But rather, he wants us to retain the name that we receive from the Father, rather than making a name for ourselves. He wants to reclaim us as his children. And so he does not allow man's plans to come to fruition, but rather scatters man, divides them. They no longer speak the same language or live in the same place. And so there's this dispersion, not only from the garden, but further. Men are separated from each other, even further. And then we have the account from Exodus where God renews the covenant with those people that he has called as his own, this people who is to be a witness to God's love and God's mercy, that God wants to restore man to his original dignity. And so that covenant that was made with Abraham is renewed in Moses. And Moses called up the mountain and given the law. The law, which was always in existence, the covenant with Abraham was clear, but now it's reinstituted with Moses and with this people whom he says he will make particularly his own. And then we hear that powerful addition to what he says there, though all men are his. And so he calls Israel not for the exclusion of the others, but rather because Israel is to be a witness to all, that God wants to call us all to be restored to him, to return to communion, that the effect of sin would not be permanent, that the division caused by sin would be healed by God. And so Moses is called up the mountain to seal that covenant. Now, we see a further division that takes place in man. With the early patriarchs, we see their lives lasted hundreds and hundreds of years. But in the end, they would die. Their bodies and their souls would separate. That division, even entering into the very fabric of human nature, the human nature comes to dissolution. and man molders in the grave, and his soul is now bereft of the gift of the body. And so we hear from the book of Ezekiel where God promises that that is going to be reversed, that he's going to send his spirit upon those bones that lay in the earth, that he's going to call man forth from the grave, that that division caused by sin is going to be healed, that all of man's dereliction, God wants to undo. He wants to restore us to himself. And that his original creation of man as a bodily being is a good that he's going to restore. And so he makes this promise in Ezekiel. We have that beautiful image of a field of bones, sinews and musculature growing back upon those bones and man rising up from the earth, the promise of the resurrection, which would be fulfilled in Christ. And how is this going to be accomplished? We hear the Lord speaking to the prophet and telling him, prophesy. Prophesy to these bones. I, Ezekiel, prophesied as I had been told. And even as I was prophesying, I heard a noise. There was a rattling as bones came together, bone joining to bone. I saw sinews and the flesh that came upon them, and the skin covered them, but there was no spirit in them. The restoration of human nature, but as it was outside the garden. And then he goes on. Then the Lord said to me, prophesy to the Spirit, prophesy, Son of Man, and say to the Spirit, thus says the Lord God, from the four winds come, O Spirit, and breathe into these slain that they may come to life. Human life is not life as God desires it without the gift of his life. He is greatly desirous of sharing his life with us. I prophesied as he told me, and the Spirit came into them. They came alive and stood upright, a vast army. And he said to me, Son of Man, these bones are the whole house of Israel. They have been saying, our bones are dried up, our hope is lost, we are cut off. The desperation of the people of Babel, who wanted to make a name for themselves, is expressed here. Our bones are dried up, our hope is lost, we are cut off. We have to make something for ourselves. And the Lord says, no. Therefore, I prophesy and say to them, thus says the Lord God, O my people, I will open your graves and have you rise from them and bring you back to the land of Israel. A foreshadowing of the paradise of heaven. He's not going to call us back to the land of Canaan to live there, but rather he's going to restore us to a new paradise, where we will once again be in a communion with him, that intimacy of family life with the Father. I will put my spirit in you that you may live, and I will settle you upon your land. Thus you shall know that I am the Lord. I have promised, and I will do it, says the Lord. And how is this to be accomplished? By the incarnation, crucifixion, death, suffering, and resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. There was, of course, no spirit yet, because Jesus had not yet been glorified. The glorification of Jesus is human nature in Christ taken into the heavenly tabernacle. And with that introduction of our nature into eternity, Father sends his Spirit anew through baptism to awaken in us the divine life that he wants to share with us. This gift of divine life comes through the sacrifice of Christ and his glorification in his human nature. He's one with the Father. What's being glorified in Jesus is his human nature, our nature. God has taken